Now we've worked our way back to the opening five measures, your statement. And here, the best thing that you can do for selling this really striking introduction is to make sure that your focus is always on the melody. The melody. Of course, slower than that and with ornaments and rolls, but would you just play the melody line, no ornaments, no rolls? Granted, it's going to go slower than that, but sometimes by playing through it a little faster, it helps us see it as one unit, one trajectory. And then even when we slow it down, we're still feeling that longer line. So now when you throw back in, and we'll talk about the intonation of the first two chords, but can you play me the first three chords such that the first two go into the third? Good. So this, even though it's on a down bow, you're crescendoing through it in a sense. That's it. Now it drives to the next downbeat. A little crescendo, more crescendo, and tall. Right? Good for you, good for you. Now this spot, I think these are four eighth notes that would be very good not to play strictly. Maybe you could linger on this first eighth. Try even more lingering on the third. Right. Something to where there's some, I mean, again, to give the impression of this recitative, which it is to be, make it as speech-like as possible. And speech always has this kind of this human unexactness to it, right? So let's hear your EB fifth. Now roll it. Good. And same EB, but of two strings lower. Good. So, and if you're not perfectly happy with it, sometimes rather than just changing the relative height of the finger up and down the string, you can change the relative pressure on it. In this case, a little bit more on the C and a little bit less on the G string. There you go. And there's, right. Now there's no need to continue to hold down the E and the B once you're on the top part of the chord. You can release them and have a chance of vibratoing that top. Good, good. You see how your pinky wants to point back at the hand, and that's suffering the E just a little bit. Good for you. How about that? Right, so there, that E, if anything, tends to be a little on the bright side. So sometimes a useful marking is to draw a downward arrow on that pitch, just to remind yourself that if anything, that tends to be a little bit too bright. And when we go on from getting from good. Can you hold the C as long as possible? Right. So second finger is going to hop in an instant, just as fast as a mousetrap snapping. There you go. But hold the C even longer. Yeah, it has to be a split second. Right. You don't get the chance in really an actual performance of this to pause and think, am I playing the right chord? You just have to fall into it. da ba ya. Right. So now, if you decide to take some license through there, again, it won't be because of technical reasons. It will be because Zuri chose to do so. Can you start from... Oops. Good. I still hear... Ba-ba-ya, ba-ba-ya. And it means... When you play just a melody, just play the melody. Yeah, so the C goes to the A. Now you have to give that illusion. Better, better. Try it again. Right, that, now that fifth is a tricky one. A lot of people who are double jointed in some other part, some other finger at the end aren't on third finger, and to get third finger to really make a nice fifth. Right, so you might, you set the hand in the most comfortable and conducive location for that fifth. No, just worry about the fifth right now. Right, and then second finger, which is the longest and one of the strongest, make her do the calisthenics that she needs to make the D sharp work without affecting third finger. Good. Do you feel how your body goes a little bit more tense before that chord? That again, that tension is another thing that is anathema to playing on stage. If anything, we need to relax at that spot. And it's just whoosh, and you just, whoops, let it be what it is. Good. Now, have the courage to leave the bow on the string to the last instant. More like that. Good, good. So, can you get that fifth where the third finger is actually somewhat between the strings so that she can have her fifth but not get in the way of that A? Can you try it where it's arched a bit, but your finger is somewhat between the strings? So, see how my finger isn't actually collapsed? You have to find exactly the right spot to be able to... That's right, keep experimenting. Right, so now it's a matter of getting the F sharp to be down just enough to speak. I think you're on the right pitch, it's just not quite down enough to be speaking. Right, now. Right, and in a worst case scenario, if you have to do it not as a 2 plus 2 chord, I mean two strings and then two strings, but as 3 and 1, so... But not lifting it enough to hear the D. Right. Would be better than having an unreliable third there, right? Yeah, yeah, right. And in that case, you cheated a little and pulled it across the string, but who cares? Yeah, that's yet another solution. Great. So let's hear the opening five bars once more. If I were you, I would put a tenuto over that C. You have to practice to have the courage to where, just practice that a couple times. Good, now. More like that. Yeah, but second finger will hop down there. ride. And if all else fails, you might even try going from a second to a 1-2-2. Shift up to low second position. Right. I mean, well, why didn't you tell me about this before? Well, I mean, I think it's good. There are passages in the cello repertoire where a third has to do that, where you cannot get out of it by doing another fingering. So it's good to make third live up to that. Now, as far as the tail end of that recitative goes, these notes go here. Right, you kind of played. So that too much of the momentum stopped before the C. Right, and same thing here too. Good. And of course, if you want to take it broader, but as long as you still have the glue going all the way from here to here. Yes. Nice job. Good work.